Morning. Good to be back with you guys. It was fun to preach at some of the other campuses, but it's always good coming home. Amen? All right, so you should be in Psalm 128. If you're not, go ahead and turn or swipe. What do you need to do to get there? While you're doing that, I'm going to share a short story with you. So when I grew up originally in New Jersey until I was 13 years old, and then we moved to the Midwest. And we lived in this fantastic street. Like, there were tons of families with kids my age. Like, it was a kid's dream in the 70s. You kick the can, ghost in the graveyard, stick ball. Like, just every night there was something going on, and you could just walk up and play. But, like, a lot of neighborhoods or a lot of communities, too, there's always those, well, they're you know, just like they are today, back then there were bullies. We had this one family lived at the end of our street and just around the corner. But they kind of were part of the street, and they were our age, and we knew them from school. And they loved to hang out and play with us, but they also at times just wanted to bully us. It was kind of like that. We like you, but we're going to be mean to you. And sometimes it was pretty serious. Like, sometimes you'd be playing a game, and they didn't like the outcome. So two of the three brothers would just start pounding on you or chase you home if you were faster than them. But one of the things they also liked to do, they had mini bikes, like little 50cc mini bikes. And when they went riding on those, if you were anywhere in their sight, they'd try to run you over. Like, I'm not exaggerating that. Like, you ran for your life. And you hid behind a tree, behind a rock. You ran to your house. You got home as fast as you could, right? I was like, this is one of the earliest moments I can really remember truly being afraid of something, being afraid for my life from these guys. What kind of things are you afraid of? Like, not back then, not when you were maybe 10 or 12 or 14 or 20, but wherever you are in your stage of life right now, what are you afraid of? And even as I ask that question, oftentimes as adults and as Christians, I'm not afraid of anything, John, especially the guy. So I'm not afraid, John, I'm a man. But fear is not just a big part of our culture in an unhealthy way. It's not just crept into the church. It's all over the place. We don't realize sometimes the things we do because we fear something. You know, sometimes we have this fear of man that, so I become a people pleaser. I do whatever I can to keep the peace or to keep people happy. I compromise, maybe even sometimes what I believe or what I think, and I just keep my mouth shut because I just want to keep everybody happy. Some of us have a fear of man. Sometimes maybe even it's at work. I fear maybe what my boss might think or my coworkers might think, so I'm just not going to stand up for somebody, or I'm not going to say something that might get me in trouble with them, even though I believe it firmly with my heart and soul. Fear of man is a big piece of our culture, even inside this building sometimes. Maybe we have a fear of failure. Maybe there are certain things we just are never going to try in life. And it's not because maybe we think, well, I'm gifted over here, I'm not gifted here. It's just I don't want to try it. I'm afraid I'm going to fail. I'm not going to try to build this relationship. I'm not going to try to be a good neighbor. I'm not going to try to this new task, whatever it is. We have a fear of failure. Maybe we're just afraid of being hurt, so we don't open up. We don't allow ourselves to be vulnerable in a small group or an accountability setting. We have no really truly close friends that know us because we're afraid of getting hurt. Maybe we have a lot of hurt in our past, and so we're now afraid of it. We're just not going to be open about it. Maybe we have a fear of being in need, right? I don't ever want to have to be in need or want, so I'm going to be a workaholic. I'm going to work really, really hard, and I'm going to store up all of this wealth and make sure that no matter what happens in this world, no matter how bad it ever gets, I'm always taken care of, and my family's always taken care of. And we love to do things like that and turn it into, well, I'm being responsible. When it's really just maybe a fear of never wanting to be in need. For some, maybe we have a fear of our kids not walking with Jesus someday. And so, again, using the cover of responsibility, we build a hedge around them. We let nothing and no one that could ever possibly, remotely, even in the slightest way, influence them away from Jesus ever come near them. And we never let them make a decision for themselves. We become these helicopter parents, and yet we call it responsibility, but it's really motivated by fear. And I could continue going on. And folks, I share none of this out of judgment. I'm not pointing fingers. But the reality is, many of us fear things and we don't even realize it. And so my hope and prayer is we're maybe willing to even sit here this morning and go, Lord, is there something that I fear that I shouldn't? Help me with it. Because there is one thing that we should fear. There's actually one thing, right? All of the things I'm talking about are worldly fear, and it's a bad thing. But there's one thing that we should fear, and that's the Lord. Scripture tells us over and over again that the fear of the Lord, it's a really good thing. In fact, when we fear God, our lives are better. Put it another way, and this is our big idea for this morning, when the fear of the Lord leads to his favor in my life. This is what we're going to unpack today. When we actually fear the Lord the way that the Bible describes, we will experience His favor in our lives. And that's not just a simple like, hey, thanks, good job, John. Like His favor, when Scripture talks about God's favor, it is abundant, it is abounding, it is overflowing, it is never ending. And it's not just being set free from sin and set free to life. It's so much more than that. Right? We're told in 1 John 14 that perfect love casts out fear. That's all these other fears we're talking about. This is the one fear that's a good fear. And when we get that right and we come under His perfect love, all of those other fears disappear. And so that's what I want to unpack this morning is what does it really look like to fear the Lord? What does this favor look like? So turn to John. Not to John, Psalm 128, you're already there, right? Because we've been told to turn. So let's read it this morning. Follow along with me in your copy of God's Word, Psalm 128. Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in His ways. You shall eat of the fruit of the labor of your hands. You shall be blessed, and it shall be well with you. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Behold, thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you see the children, your children's children, and peace be upon Israel. It's a beautiful picture of the Lord's blessing in our life, all built around the fear of the Lord. So what is the fear of the Lord in my life? Let's unpack that. Let's unpack the fear of the Lord in my life so that we can better understand and know what it looks like to fear Him so that we can know His favor in our lives. Verse 1, right? Everyone who fears the Lord. This is a good thing. In fact, Proverbs 19:23 says, the fear of the Lord leads to life. Let me first start by talking about what it's not. Because too often, I think we misunderstand this aspect. We think God is somebody we should actually be afraid of. And the idea of fearing the Lord and being afraid of Him are two different things. What it's not is this, it's not hiding from Him. God's not somebody, when you do something wrong, when you blow it, however big, you don't have to hide from Him. Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve. They ate a piece of fruit. They didn't kill anybody. They didn't have an affair. All the things that we might label as really, really big deal. They didn't steal. They just ate a piece of fruit. And they ran and they hid from God. Maybe they feared retribution. Maybe they feared punishment. Maybe, I don't know what. But they were afraid of Him, so they went and they hid. That's not what we're talking about. That's the worldly fear that perfect love casts out. We don't have to hide from God. If you're saved, if you're His child here this morning, you don't ever have to hide from God, no matter how much you've blown it. It's also not being afraid of Him. In Israel, in Exodus chapter 20, God is there. People are around Mount Sinai, and there's Moses, and God is giving them the Ten Commandments. And the people see God's power on the mountain. They see the cloud, and they are afraid. So much so, they tell Moses, listen, Moses, we're going to stay over here, and you keep talking to God. We're afraid. He seems so powerful, and we think that, you know, if we do the slightest thing wrong, He might squash us like He did the Egyptians. So we're just afraid. We want you to intervene, and we don't want to talk to Him. We don't want to approach Him. We're afraid of Him. And yet we're told in the New Testament, the veil's been torn down. We can walk into the Holy of Holies as the children of God. And we can come before Abba, Daddy, and we can talk to Him. We don't have to be afraid. We don't have to hide. And lastly, it's not about shame or guilt or any of that stuff either. In Genesis chapter 18, Abraham and Sarah are old, way beyond childbearing years. And the Lord tells them, hey, you guys are going to have kids. And Sarah laughs. I think if I remember the story correctly, I'm not opening it right now, but she's actually maybe even overhearing or listening to the conversation. It says that she laughed. And later on, the Lord comes back to talk to him again, but this time Sarah's right there, and the Lord's like, yeah, you remember when you laughed? But then we're told, if you look up the story, she was afraid. And so she said, I didn't laugh. Maybe there was a little bit of shame. Maybe there was a little bit of guilt, embarrassment. That's not the fear that I'm talking about. That same fear, that shame, that guilt and embarrassment all gets wiped away with the perfect love of Christ. That is not the love of God. Please hear that. So what is it, right? When we say everyone who fears the Lord, and later in verse 4 again talks about fearing the Lord, what is it? Well, I have a definition I want to share with you. I kind of made it up from my studies this week. Nothing is going to capture this perfectly, but I'm trying to do my best to capture the fear of the Lord, and this is what it is. To fear God is to know Him, love Him, respect him and obey him above everything else. Notice that last part of the phrase, above everything else. That's really the clincher. Yes, you've got to know him first and foremost as a child of God and continue to get to know him. You've got to love him above everything else. You've got to respect him above everything else. And you've got to obey him above everything else. All of these other fears of the world need to shrink and disappear because we fear him first and foremost. Deuteronomy chapter 10 says this, verses 12 and 13. And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you? But, here it is again, to fear the Lord your God. And then they kind of unpack that, which is what we just did. To walk in all his ways, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to keep the commandments and statutes of the Lord. So when we talk about fearing the Lord, it starts with knowing him and loving him, respecting him. What we're getting after is this. It starts with our posture. Fearing the Lord starts with my posture. It starts with recognizing what we just sang. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. But it's not just singing a song. It's not just saying that out loud. It's actually a heart position and a posture that recognizes he is King Jesus. He's Lord of heaven and earth. Yes, he actually could squash me like a bug. But because of his grace and balanced with his power, he won't. But it starts with a posture that recognizes him for all that he is and recognizes he alone is God. He is Yahweh. Again, who are we fearing? Look at your text, because look at the wording. When you see in the Old Testament the word Lord written there, right, the fear of the Lord, and it's in all miniature capital letters, that's the Hebrew word Yahweh, the number one word used for the name of God, number one name of God used throughout the Old Testament. But it's not just that, it's the covenant name of God. It's the name that God revealed to Moses on Mount Sinai the first time he was there at the burning bush. But it's the name of God that kind of captures all of the other names. And so when we say fear the Lord, you're fearing the creator and the sustainer of life. You're fearing the one who has all power and has all knowledge, who is everywhere at all time, who is always working for his glory and our good. You're fearing the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the Alpha and the Omega, the one who is over all things. This is what it is to have the right posture, to revere him for who he is, to stand in awe of God for who he is, to recognize that, yes, he is so powerful with the blink of an eye he could wipe me off the face of the earth, and yet he won't because of his grace. There's this combination in my posture of a fear and trembling because I know who you are, I know how mighty and powerful you are, but I don't back away because of grace. In fact, I can approach you because of grace, but I do so maybe with a little bit of tremble in my step. You know, think back to growing up, telling that story. I had a really good relationship with my dad. And so this is something that may be easier for me than some. If maybe your dad was a jerk, unfortunately, and I don't mean to say that meanly, but sometimes this is hard to get God as father and God as all these things when maybe our earthly dads weren't the best. My dad wasn't perfect, but he did a good job. And I can say I walked around with this kind of reverence of my dad. I had a healthy fear. I knew that when I blew it, dad was coming home. Punishment was coming. Now, it was never a beating. It was never a hitting. But you just knew, like, and it was also the disappointment. I had let my dad down. But I had seen his power, and yet I had experienced his grace. And I revered my dad. Those same bullies that used to try to run us over with their mini bikes. There was this one day I'll never forget. Obviously, I'll never forget it. Well, maybe someday I will, but I haven't forgotten it yet. We were out playing like we were in the street, and we heard the brothers coming. You can hear those things screaming from a mile away, right? And then we saw them. And then we looked at each other with panic in our eyes, like, where are we going to hide? Can we get home before they get here? Can we beat them to our doorstep? And just as we started to run, this was 1970, like seven, right? So this is pre-cell phone, pre-anything, right? I don't know how this happened, if it was coordinated or it was a move of God. But as we start to run, I see my dad come flying out of the backyard. I see my other friend's dad, and I see another dad. These three dads had come out, and as these boys were zipping by on their bikes, because they now realized, uh-oh, we got to get home and get away, because the dads were, each one of them happened to get close enough and grabbed one of these boys off their bikes, and the bikes just kept zipping on by. You could do this in the 70s. Not today. To be filmed and you'll be arrested. And it didn't harm them. They didn't hurt them, right? But they were protecting their children. There was power in that moment. They had those boys. And I remember my dad held this kid by the collar and he set him down. And I'm behind this rock at this point. Like, oh my gosh, look at my dad. Woohoo! Right? And he put him down. And I could hear my dad. He's like, are you ever going to come near our kids again with these bikes? No, sir. No, sir. No, 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 sir. I won't. I promise. I never promise. I promise. Okay. That's all the dads did, and they let him go. But there was this moment as a kid, like, look at that power. Nobody's ever going to mess. Like, that whole argument, like, my dad could beat up your dad. I believed it from the depth of my soul. And there was this just beautiful picture of, look at the power of my dad. But the grace that he loves me and he's doing his best for me. There's a posture that it starts with if we want to fear God. And it's hard, folks, I'm going to acknowledge, it's hard to maintain this posture. Everything in the world is trying to distract us from it, to get our eyes off it, to get us to fear something else besides our great and awesome God. But the fear of the Lord should draw us to him, should help us keep our eyes on him when life gets tough. I had this fear of my dad, and I just wanted to be like him. I wanted to be around him as much as I possibly could. The fear of the Lord should be drawing us to him in every situation and scenario. Because the moment I fear anything else, maybe it was on the list I opened up with, or maybe it's something that's already else popped into your head that you're realizing you maybe fear more than God, I do this. And now my eyes are on whatever I fear. And I'm not saying like we've lost our salvation, but my back is to God because my eyes are so much on this. I'm not fearing him, I'm fearing this over him. But the moment I get drawn to him in this fear of God, that just disappears. It's there no more because my eyes are on him and my fear is on him the way it should be. When we fear something more than God, we turn our back on him. We need to keep our eyes on him. We need to fear him more above anything else. And this fear should draw us closer and closer to him so that we don't just know him through salvation. We want to continue to get to know this great and awesome God. Again, thinking back to my dad, just the older I got and the things that I saw him do and I saw his wisdom and I saw how he maybe worked so hard, but he did so to bless his family, how he protected us and provided for us. And as I got older, I even understand it better and more intimately, and my love and my respect for him grew even more so. It's no different with the Lord. We've got to work and we've got to fight to keep our eyes on him and keep our posture set up the right way. But it's not just about our posture. Look back at the text. Right, still in verse 1. Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. Our posture moves to practice. It's a both end. You can't have one without the other. You can't say that, man, I fear the Lord. I love the Lord. I respect the Lord above anybody else. I love him and I love him and I love him, but not obey. My practice has to match my posture. And I can't say, well, I'm just really good at doing all these things for the Lord. I don't really love him. You know, he's not really driving my life, but I'm going to do stuff for him. I'm going to be really busy for him and try to be a nice guy all the time. It's a both and. To truly fear him, it involves my posture and my practice. Remember, we're saying that you have to know him, love him, respect him, and obey him. Again, the text, who walks in his ways, and that's obedience. I mentioned Moses earlier, right? Do you remember the story in the burning bush? I relate to that because that's my own call into ministry. All the excuses I made 30 years ago when the Lord was trying to get me into ministry, I made every one of the same excuses Moses made. But something shifts in that meeting, right? Moses walks into this meeting trembling, I think more of worldly fear in the moment, standing on holy ground. And the Lord's like, I want you to go free my people. No. I want you to go free my people. Yeah, I have no idea what to say. I'm not smart enough. I want you to go free my people. I'm going to stutter. I'm not really a good speaker. You probably need to get somebody else. I need you to go free my people. No, I just don't want to go. Not a good fear. But if you read the story later, in the middle of that conversation, when Moses, he makes the excuse, well, listen, I'm going to go. They're not going to listen to me, so what do I tell them? Because I'm a nobody. You tell them that I am sent you. And that's when Moses learns about Yahweh. I am. He learns who Yahweh is, the Lord. And he leaves that meeting very different when he started that meeting and would proceed to have 40 years of fearing the Lord and amazing ministry. In that moment, Moses reset so that his posture and understanding of who God was right. And so for the next 40 years, his practice would be healthy as well. Folks, how many in the church today, right, say we believe in God, but we really don't walk in his ways? We say we have the right posture, but our practice doesn't really match it. And I think it's because we don't really truly fear him. Our posture isn't right. It's off. I said it earlier, right? A lot of times we'll even try to justify our fear of something else by responsibility. Well, I'm just trying to keep the peace in the family. So I'm just going to, you know, give in to everybody to keep the peace so nobody fights. I'm just trying to protect my child from maybe ever walking away, so I'm not going to ever let them make decisions or hang out with anybody or talk to anybody, whoever might not even, you know the Lord. They can only hang out with Christians and Christian things and Christian people. I'm just being responsible to my family so that we're never in need, so I got to make sure we have enough saved up, so just in case. We're really good at that. We're really good at disguising our fear. And maybe this is a wake-up call for some of us to even just at least begin to admit, you know, I fear something else. Or maybe for some of us whose practice is way off, and maybe our posture is way off, and today's the day we reset those things. Listen to this. This is Isaiah chapter 11, verse 3. It's talking about Jesus. This is a prophecy talking about Jesus written hundreds of years before he came. But it says, and Jesus' delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. Even Jesus walked in the fear of the Lord. How that beautiful mystery works, I can't fully comprehend. But he walked in the fear of the Lord, and it was a delight. Folks, if what I'm talking about to you seems like a chore, seems like something you have to do, this takes us right back to our posture. It takes us back to our heart. Then something's off. It's a heart issue. Everything we have as a Christian, everything we get to do as a Christian should be a delight. Not a duty, but a delight. Fearing the Lord should be a delight. Getting to know him more and more should be a delight. Obeying him should be a delight. And if it's not, it tells us that our posture is off. My eyes aren't on him. I'm not fearing him above all else. I'm fearing something else. Or maybe I just revere myself more than I revere him. But this is why maybe it's a gut check that if any of this sounds like a chore or a responsibility, there's something off in our posture because it should be a delight. In fact, listen to what Proverbs 14:27 says. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life that one may turn away from the snares of death. A fountain of life. The town that we came here from in Arizona, Fountain Hills, Arizona. It's called Fountain Hills because it's in the foothills of the Phoenix area, but it had what used to be the world's largest fountain. Somebody like in Baha'i now built a bigger one, but it's 560 feet. It's taller than the Washington Monument, shooting straight up into center town. It's beautiful. Beautiful to see with the mountains in the background. It's absolutely, and it just, you can just sit there. You can see it from 8, 10, 12 miles away if you're up in the mountains, and you can just see it. It's really, really cool. And I just think that the fear of the Lord is like that fountain that just shoots 600 feet in the air. That's what the Lord has for us. When we fear the Lord, his blessings, his favor is just going to be like this fountain. And so when we know him and respect him and worship him and obey him above everything else, right, this fear of the Lord is going to lead to greater favor in our lives, folks. Maybe we need a posture reset. Maybe we need a practice reset. But let's continue to chew on that as we unpack, right? We said we want to unpack the fear of the Lord. Now let's unpack this favor and what it looks like. Verse 1 again. We're going to move on, don't worry, but verse 1 again still. Right? The Lord's talking about the Lord's favor in my life. Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord. That word blessed, we're talking again, as we've already said, about God's favor in our lives. We could sit here and talk about, right, sometimes the seasons of health that he provides us, or how he provides for us, or how he keeps us safe in certain situations, how he grants us peace or joy, how he gives us comfort or courage or hope or strength and so much more. We could sit here and talk about the greatest favor that we have, right? I was lost, and now I'm found. I was a slave, and now I'm free. I was in chains, but now I'm victorious. I was a child of Satan, and now I'm a child of the Lord for all eternity. God's favor is beyond our comprehension, and yet we get to see it and experience it. And we're talking about all of this and so much more. But our passage points out three specific areas of our lives. And so let's unpack that. Verse 2. You shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands. You shall be blessed and it shall be well with you. You shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands and it shall be well with you. Right? You read this and you think, oh, hey, wait a minute. So if I fear the Lord, everything's going to go well for me. Isn't that what he just said? If I fear the Lord, it's all going to work out the way I'm planning, the way I hope, the way I want it to go. If I fear the Lord, it's all going to work out for me. Is that what it said? No. Seemed to. And when we do fear the Lord, and when we do walk in his ways, more often than not, they do go that way. But it's not specifically like, hey, listen, if you walk in, if you do this, right, if you walk in the fear of the Lord, your job's going to go exactly the way you want it. You're going to get every promotion you want, every raise that you want. You're always going to have what you need. It's always going to be perfect. Let's not forget Psalm 127 that Pastor Jeff taught last week, right? Remember it said, unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. It is in vain that you rise up early and go to late rest. What this is really saying is this. If you're working for the Lord in whatever you do, you will be blessed and it will go well with you. It doesn't mean you're necessarily going to get the job that you want or you're going to get the promotion, but you're going to know his favor as long as you're working faithfully for the Lord in the fear of the Lord. You're going to see God's favor in your personal life is the point of this. First area you're going to see God's favor is in your personal life. H.B. Charles wrote this. He said this, because we can read this psalm and think, right, this is a promise, word for word. It's not. The psalm does not guarantee health or wealth and success. The psalm teaches godly principles, not guaranteed promises. And the principle is, if I fear the Lord and I walk in his ways, in my personal life, I'm going to see his favor. How you're going to see that is up to him. It might very well be that you get that next promotion. It might very well be that you have the money to get that house that you wanted. It might very well be those things. But it might also be that, hey, things aren't going the way you wanted, but he's going to give you his favor in so many other ways that you didn't realize you needed it. I mentioned the town of Fountain Hills earlier in Arizona, where we came from. I don't know if you all know the full story of how we ended up here. But if you heard Pastor Jeff's sermon last week, he told a story in the beginning about, it was an imaginary story of two pastors. And they got the same training, the same degrees, same organization, going to the same city to plant two churches. And this guy planted a church, and this guy planted a church, and they were supporting each other and praying for each other, encouraging each other. And this guy's church exploded, hundreds and then thousands of people. And this church never got off the ground really beyond 150. Right, unless the Lord builds the house. We labor in vain. And as he's telling that story, my wife and I, Amy and I, are sitting there going, that's our story. And this is the part maybe you didn't know, but we went to the training center here at Harvest, and we went to Phoenix, and we were one of four churches, one of four Harvest Bible Chapels planted in Phoenix. The other three were planted before us, and so they were going to help coach us and come around us, and they were all super successful, still all there, doing great ministry for the Lord. Good friends, pastors are good friends. So we came in thinking, we're next. This is going to be great. The Lord is in this. The Lord's going to do this. And 7 years later, that church closed, and that's why we're here. I needed to find a new job. In the midst of that, I can tell you it was very hard to see the Lord's favor in my personal life. Lord, I'm working hard. I'm fearing you, I'm working hard. Why is this church not, you know, exploding like everybody else's? I'm working hard. Where is it? Where is it? His favor is going to come how he wants to bring it. In that season, it wasn't in the growth of a church. And I can say it's easier to see looking back for sure, but the way that he sustained us in the midst of it, the way that he provided for us every week, the way that he took care of my family, we never lost hope. Even when we were discouraged, we never lost hope and we knew he was doing something. And then to end up here, which I never would have picked or dreamed or imagined, but so grateful to be here. His favor is going to be how he wants to give it, but we will see his favor in our personal life when we walk in his ways, folks. And if you continue to struggle to see it, I would say simply two things. Make sure you're fearing the Lord. Make sure you're walking in ways. Always go back into a posture check and a practice check. If I'm not seeing God's favor, is my posture right? If I'm not seeing God's favor, is my practice right? Because if it is, you will see it in some way, shape, or form. And if you're still struggling, let's also remember Job. Right? Here's a man who seemed to be the most godly man on the planet at the time. And then lost family and lost wealth and seemed to lose everything, even his health. And he even in the midst of his faithfulness, he still needed a subtle reset. He still needed a subtle reset on his posture. And he got it. When God showed up, he got it big time. I love this part of the story. Not just because God puts him in his place, but I love the humble realization of Job. Job 42, verse 2. I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. And he's still sitting in his boils. He's still sitting in his dirt. He still hasn't gotten his family back. He still hasn't gotten his wealth back. His wife still hates him. And yet he realizes, Lord, your favor comes as your favor comes. It's up to you. I just need to faithfully follow you. I need to have the right posture and the right practice. When I see fear the Lord, I'll see his favor in my personal life. The second one, verse 3. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Again, not a promise, but simply presenting good practices as believers. Paul, again, is not Paul. The author is writing to who? Israel, who would sing this psalm as they were walking up, right? The Psalms of Ascent, as they're walking up to Jerusalem. And what was, right, in Israel at that time, culturally, what was the dream of every family? To have sons. Because why? The sons carry on the family name. The sons continue to run the family business. The sons are the ones who get the inheritance. And so this is the picture of the perfect thing. I'm a man, and I've got a wife, and she loves me, and she's pleasant to be with. This is wonderful. And now we have children, and they're just all around the table, and I have a whole bunch of them, and there's a bunch of boys. And so the Lord is using what is considered the ideal life, right? Even seeing your grandchildren, in verse 6, it talks about, right, that prayer, may you see your children's children. That's the dream of a Jewish family. And he's saying, listen, this is what you hold so tightly. And so again, if you walk in the fear of me and you walk in my ways, you're going to see my favor in these scenarios. But it's not, again, a promise of family necessarily as much as it is about relationships. The second place we see God's favor is in our relationships. Because again, what about Paul? What about Jesus? Did they not get God's favor because they didn't have a wife and kids? It's easy to read a passage like this and think, oh, I must not be walking in God's favor because I haven't gotten married yet. We've been unable to have children. We don't know God's favor. This is a lie. And again, it's not teaching a promise. It's teaching a principle. And the principle is, when I walk in the fear of the Lord and when I walk in his ways, I will see his favor in my relationships. That's the principle. And it might very well be your marriage. It might very well be with your children. But I can tell you, even if you're in a home, if you're sitting here today and you're like, yeah, but John, I'm doing my best right now, but my spouse doesn't know the Lord, and my kids don't know the Lord and don't really like me. But if you're walking in the fear of the Lord, those relationships are still going to be blessed. Do we see that connection? Because I'm walking in the fear of the Lord, my home is going to be a better place to be. Even if they aren't, I am. And oh, by the way, I have a chance to influence them and bring the favor of God into their life. If I don't walk in the fear of the Lord, I have a lot less relationships in my life because I'm a jerk. But if I fear the Lord, like seriously, without the Lord, woo, you don't want to know me. But when I walk in the favor of the Lord, I bring that into every situation I'm in, every relationship I'm in. And so my marriage just got better, even if my wife doesn't love the Lord, but I do and I love her. Even my kids don't want to follow the Lord, but I do and I love them. His favor will come in and it will be better. And every relationship we have, for that matter. We're told to walk in his ways, right? Going back to our text. So we're given an opportunity as well. Part of this favor is the opportunity to teach my spouse or my kids or anybody in my life that I come across about how to walk in the fear of the Lord, how to fear him and walk in his ways. And we also get to be, like I said, we get to bring God's favor into our families, into our homes, into our relationships. Let me ask you a question. Whether it's in your home with your spouse and children, or maybe it's with some of your good friends, or maybe even your employee, maybe you're the boss and you have an employee. Let's look at the relationships in our lives. We get God's, as God's children, we get God's favor in abundance, not as condemnation. So if you're going to walk in the fear of the Lord and walk in his ways, in those relationships, do those people experience more of your favor or more of your condemnation? I've been guilty of this far too much. And I've had to seek forgiveness from family and friends. Part of the favor of the Lord in our lives and in our relationships is that we get to bring his favor into our relationships. And let's never forget this as well. Who are we talking about? Who are we fearing here? The Lord, Yahweh, the perfect, infinite, wise, and loving, and good God. He's the only one who's ever going to truly fulfill relationship-wise, folks. As great as the gift that we have in each other, in our marriages, in our children, in our church family, we have right here in this room, as great as this gift is, not any one of these nor all of these combined will ever truly meet our needs and fulfill us. Only Yahweh can do that. Part of his favor in our lives that we get to bring and to share with everybody else around us. When we fear the Lord, we will see his favor in our relationships as well as our personal life. Let me point this out before we move on to the last point. Look at verse 4. Right? He just talked about God's favor in your personal life, God's favor in your relationships. And then he says this, but behold, thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. Where did that blessing come from? Not yourself. From the Lord. Because you fear the Lord is going to work out this blessing in your life. So just, to me, this was just a good reminder as I was studying this week, right? So if I have success in my job, if what I lay my hands to do for work goes well, who gets the credit? The Lord. Why? Because he built the house. If I walk in the fear of the Lord and I walk in his ways in my home and my marriage is going really, really well right now, and we're in a great season, and maybe my spouse even loves the Lord right there alongside of me, who gets the credit? The Lord, because he's building that house. And if I happen to be in a home where my kids also follow the Lord with their heart, soul, mind, and strength, and don't go walk in the stupid, idiotic ways I did as a child, and they avoid them and save themselves much more pain and anguish than I had, and they're loving Jesus with their heart, who gets that credit? The Lord. The Lord's the one who blesses us. The Lord's the one who pours his favor on us. Let's make sure he gets the credit. Also a good reminder, again, to fear the Lord because he's the one who does all of this and to walk in his ways. The last way that we are blessed, verse 5, the Lord bless you from Zion, right? This is a prayer, right? May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. We had talked about the children piece already. And then the last part of verse 6, peace be upon Israel. This is a prayer. This is a hope for further blessing. And so how do we see his favor here? Well, I believe this has to do with the community around us, where we live, right? The Jewish people, he talks about Jerusalem, talks about the nation of Israel, peace be upon Israel, which they were all Israelites. Jerusalem was the city they were all going to. May you see, right, God's favor where you go and where you are. Same for us. May we see this favor. We hope and we pray we see our favor in Algonquin or Lake in the Hills or Crystal Lake in the specific neighborhoods that we work. But guess what? Guess who also gets to bring their favor there? In fact, when the nation of Israel, this is years after this psalm would be written, when Israel was put into, they were exiled and put into captivity, this is what they were told. Jeremiah 29 says this, seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord in its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare. We see God's favor in our communities when we take God's favor into our communities. When we get involved in our communities and we seek the welfare of our towns and our neighborhoods, the places that we work. In the history of America, many of the caring institutions that were started up at one point or another, schools, hospitals, different welfare organizations by Christians. Schools like Harvard and Yale were started to be schools, seminaries for pastors. Lost their way, of course, but they were started that way because people went into their community and brought God's favor with them. We get to do the same thing. It's not a chore. It's a delight. I get to get involved in kids' sports. I get to maybe be a child mentor in the schools. I get to volunteer in some way, shape, or form in my town, or maybe be a participant with Safe Homes, or maybe foster people. We don't have to start organizations necessarily, but there are so many ways. Simply by being a good neighbor, I can bring God's favor into my neighborhood. You have any of the Christians in your neighborhood that you know of? There's some there. You just may not know them yet. I know of at least 3 or 4, one right across the street from me, a couple around the corner. Some of you live in my neighborhood. I know. What if we got together with maybe all the other Christians, if we found them, we could bring God's favor to that community. You know what would happen? I want to find out. We will see God's favor in our community when we come together and we walk in the, we fear the Lord and we walk in his ways. The fear of the Lord leads to his favor in my life. Just think about that for another second. And his blessings are unlimited and never-ending for everyone who fears him. One last thing in the text. Go back to verse 1 if you still have it open. Blessed is everyone. Not everyone in the world, everyone who fears the Lord. So two things about that. Everyone who fears the Lord, there's no limit, there's no end. You're a child of God here today. There's no limit, there's no end to the blessings of God in your life. Rejoice in that. Celebrate that. Clamor for more of that. Walk in the fear of the Lord. But folks, if by chance you're here this morning and you don't fear the Lord, let me ask you this question. Do you know him? Because it starts with knowing him. Do you know the Lord? We can be good at hiding in a church for decades and never actually surrendering our heart to Him, never trusting Jesus as Lord and Savior. Maybe you're here for the first or second week and this whole Christianity thing's new to you, but if you don't actually know the Lord, if you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, none of this is true for you. I want it to be desperately. But these blessings come for those who fear the Lord, who know Him and love Him and respect Him and obey Him. And so if by chance you don't yet know Him, Pastor Brian and I will be up here at the end of this. Please come up and talk to us. We'd love to help you take that step so that you can begin to get to know Him and walk in His ways. If you're sitting here this morning and you do know Him confidently, how's your posture? Are we willing to ask that question? It's a great question to ask from time to time as a child of God. To just during your time with Him in the morning, Lord, how's my posture? Where am I off? Is there something I've maybe given my attention to? Is there something I'm fearing more than You? Let's get it aligned properly and love Him with our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And lastly, how's your practice? It's got to take both. Is there an area that maybe the Lord has already brought into your mind this morning of disobedience that you know you need to correct? So whether it's your posture or your practice, show up at small group this week and share with your accountability partners. Go home and tell your spouse, I need to get my posture aligned. I need to get my practice aligned. I need help. I need prayer. I need accountability. I need encouragement. Let's be men and women who walk in the fear of the Lord. Why? Because it leads to God's favor in my life. Amen? Did you guys pray with me? Jesus, thank You for this morning. Thank You for our church family. I know for me personally, this has been such a gift. I just look out at these men and women and I show up here on a Sunday and to me, it's just Your hand of favor on my life. And I guess that's really true for all of us, but from everything Amy and I had been through, this is such a gift of Your favor. You are a good God who blesses us abundantly, more than we could ever ask or imagine. Your favor surrounds us and I know that many days I even miss seeing it. You're good to us even when we aren't necessarily fearing You. Even if we briefly turn our back to fear something else, You are still good and You still pour Your favor on us. But God, we know that when we do fear You and walk in Your ways, that's what leads to life. That's what leads to joy and hope and living a light of delight and not duty. And so God, I pray for us. Help us to fear You. Stir in our hearts a hunger and a thirst to want to know You more and love You more and obey You more. Help us, Lord. Take away the distractions in our lives. I pray You would, Your perfect love would destroy the other things that maybe we fear in our life and that You would set us free from those things so we can walk in the fear of You and walk in Your ways. God, I pray that we would be a church family that would overflow with Your favor because we walk in the fear of who You are. Give us strength, give us hope, give us all that we need in this season. Help us in these moments to reset our posture, to reset our practice. Give us the courage to ask for help where we need it. God, make us a people that fear You and walk in Your ways. I ask and I pray. In Your name, Jesus. Amen.